National Education Policy 2020, and basically I will be talking about some of the issues and concerns. So before going to the issues and concerns, let us know something about this National Education Policy. So definitely it's a very bold statement, experiment by the Government of India, and as already stated by our previous speakers, that it has taken nearly 75 years for India to realize and decide and to lay a new foundation that we need a national education policy which will not be in the line with our earlier education policies. So the report itself is very self-critical, and in the light of all these things we'll discuss. So the question is, what went wrong with the education? We are having 75 years of our independence, and yes, any problem? The question is, we had two education policies, especially in the year 1968 and then 86, and then the education policy of 1986. It was also further amended in the year 1992. Then we have National Curriculum Framework in the year 2005, and then again, we have another framework related to the technical education in 2009. And then, what went wrong with our education? If you just see the education, what went wrong? So, this slide is clearly depicting what went wrong with our education system, that it is not taking care of the needs of the learner. Like everyone has to learn everything without the need and requirement, without understanding and without assessing what actually they need to learn, without focusing on the quality, without focusing on the skill, and without focusing on the learning part. The focus on the rote learning, as already stated by our previous speakers. Most importantly, the idea of Bharat, I'm not saying this idea of India, rather Bharat, it is completely distorted. Because India is a country, our country, Bharat is a country which is having three names, India, Bharat, and Hindustan. And remember, only Bharat is the name which is given by we ourselves. And rest of the two names, India as well as Hindustan, this is given by the invaders, foreigners. And the idea of India and idea of Bharat, it is completely distorted. And now what was given? The story of India. Basically, we have been told that India was a land of snake charmers. And when we have been taught the history of India, the story of India, it is given an apprehension or the meaning that Indian history is basically the history of defeats. Whosoever came to India, we have been taught like that. That whosoever came to India, right from the Alexander to the British, and everybody defeated Indians. And the glorious part of the Indian history is not taught to the students. What went wrong with the Indian education system? Too much of mathematics, very few history, little history. Another problem. No learning, only examination. As sir has rightly stated, only the students has to just cram and then the mug up and then just vomit in the examination. But what whether the learning is actually happening or not, that's a big issue. But so long as the focus is on only examination, without any focus or without any understanding on the learning part. So this is another wrong thing which has happened with our Indian. So far as the languages are concerned, so much of the focus on a foreign language, on English. And remember that when a child is born, he is born with certain instincts, certain features. And we actually, I'm telling to all my kids also that during this lockdown, when you are not going to the school, your creativity is enhanced. So nowadays, what is a school? A school is a place which is trying to kill the creativity of a student in the name of language learning. in the name of like so much of the focus on learning a language is that the focus on skill is totally distorted. It totally erased. Only a focus that we had to learn a language. Not we are not the child is not going to the school to learn some skill. A battery of unemployed. And interestingly, if you just see the history or the statistics of unemployment, we'll find that none of the uneducated people are unemployed. The unemployment term is always associated with educated employment. We'll very hardly find that any uneducated person is unemployed. So whether our education system is creating a pool, an army of unemployed, because so long as a person is not educated, he or she is not unemployed. Once the person is educated, he becomes unemployed. So that is again a testimony to my previous statement that we are sending our kids to a school or college to learn how to remain unemployed because the schools and colleges are just killing the creativity of that student. The skill, they are not, the focus is not learning, they are not learning anything. Now, what is there in this National Education Policy 2020? So, the focus is on learning without the barrier of stream and discipline. I will not go into this because it has already been stated by right from our Dean sir to our previous two speakers. Learning on mother tongue, that for the first 5 years, the students, they has to learn in their mother tongue. Focus on assessment and not examination. This is a very important. Now, till now, there has to be a focus on examination only. But now, the National Education Policy, it is stressing that there should be a focus on assessment and not on the examination. Only the God can examine whether our life is worth living or not. Or the doctor can examine because doctor is also next to the God. And nobody else is able to examine our life. So, rather the term examination itself is not acceptable, and the focus, that's why I'm using the term assessment. There has to be multiple exit options, and so modular courses has to be launched by the universities. So this is one issue which has to be addressed, and how it has to be done, this is a concern, because in a bureaucratic system, in university model, this framing a course curriculum with multiple exit options, and therefore this framing a modular courses will be a difficult task. Globalization of education has to be there, and as per the National Education Policy, it will be there, and that's why the focus will be on competency, because only the fittest and the most competent will be able to survive. Because it may so happen that Singh sir has just said that in Guwahati, there may be a branch of Harvard Business School. And so, definitely, the good pool of students, they will be opting for the Harvard Business School. So, if we are not able to maintain our competency, definitely, it will be difficult for us to survive. Focus on skill. As I told that so long as our education is there, it is not focusing on the skill. And we are sending our kids just to unlearn all the skills and creativity in the school. So now the National Education Policy, it stresses on the learning of skills, and therefore this skill will deal with the problem of unemployment. And if we just see the Gandhian model of education or NCN model of education, Gandhiji has also stressed upon this Bunyadi Siksha or the basic education, where the student will be going to the school and every student has to have a mastery in some of the craft or the skill. And that's how the dignity of labor will be restored in the students right at the school level. But that model was never implemented. And now that's why we have a barrier in our mind that this work is good and this work is not good. That since we are educated, we are not supposed to do a certain task and we are supposed to do only a particular set of activities only. So rather, when I was just reading through this National Education Policy draft, just the first thing which is coming to my mind was the Gandhian model of education, where the Gandhiji have also stressed upon and focused that every school should be independent of the state interference. And it was in ancient India, remember, it was also there. In ancient India, every village was having their own school, and all these schools were funded and maintained by the society itself, and they were independent, and they were not having, there was not any kind of state influence, interference in the running and management of the schools. And the students, every student have to learn some or the other craft, so that the student, there will be two benefits of learning this thing, that once, the number one, the students will be having a skill which he or she will be learning, and that will be throughout his life. And number two, the dignity of labor. The students will feel the dignity of labor at the school level itself. Koi bhi dhanda chota nahi hota aur dhande se bada koi dharm nahi hota. So this is a big question. Now the question is, what this new education policy is stressing upon with respect to learning? Hello? Learning. So the learning, how to learn. Now what is there in learning? Learning is not for clearing examinations, but to create life. That should be the motto of learning. We are learning, like our mother, most of the housewives, they learn how to cook, how to clean, how to cook, how to keep the house in a good shape. So all these are the different learnings. But if they are asked to clear examinations, then they will be simply clearing examinations, but they will not learn anything. So learning is for not for clearing examinations, but to create life. And learning not happen by rote learning. This is again second. And preparation for exam does not imply learning. So long as we are just preparing for exams right from our class KG or nursery till the PhD level, we are simply preparing for exams and we are not learning anything. This is the very hard and the crude and the brutal reality of our today's education system. So now the learning and teaching, it's a joint entity. So long as the teaching is one part and the learning is another part, learning actually there was no, not at all any focus on learning. So teaching was considered as one entity and preparing for exam was another entity. Now in the new education system, especially in the higher education, this learning and teaching happens, has to be the joint entity. And I will just share, I will just discuss how this is happening, learning and teaching. Now there has to be assessment of learner, not examination. There has to be assessment, and it should just happen because somebody has learned something and it's assessment, it should just happen. But simply, if a learner is preparing that it has to be assessed and it is only focusing on the assessment part and examination part, then that is not going to help any of the stakeholders, neither the students nor the teachers nor the society nor the government. So the learning should just, the assessment should just happen, but the focus is not on the assessment, but the focus should be on learning. And this new education policy, it is stressing on this part only. Okay. Now, what about this management? So all these things are actually applicable to management education only. So I'm not segregating anything that this is applicable to management or not. So all these things are actually applicable to management as it is applicable to other departments or other disciplines. Now the focus is on learning outcome. Professor Singh has rightly focused on that there has to be learning outcome. And the learning has to reach the outcome expected. So if a student has learned something, then what will be the outcome? So that outcomes has to be defined. And teaching should ensure that learner satisfies that outcome. That should be the job of a teacher in the new education policy, new framework. And the learning has to be continuous. It should not be that only on the day of examination we are learning. It has to be continuous. And if learning has to be continuous, assessment also has to be continuous. And if assessment has to be continuous, now see, how can we do away with the examination system? The assessment, it can be through project, it can be through term papers, it can be through assignment, it can be through presentations, it can be through anything. So the focus is on assessment, not on assessment, focus should be on learning. And along with the learning, there has to be some assessment, but examination is not mandatory. And in our Indian Institute of Information Technology, we have implemented this 2 years back. So during this COVID pandemic, perhaps the Indian Institute of Information Technology is the only institute in India which has completed everything, its assessment, its declaration of result, and the starting of the new batch in July, everything on time, even though there was a COVID pandemic and there was a lockdown. Because the assessment, we have our focus, our ordinance, it says that we should not focus on the examination, and we can assess the learner through any means. For example, I am teaching accounting, so I have given the assignment to the students that I will not take your examination. And a group of students were given certain assignment, like one group of students were given an assignment that there is a temple in our campus, so just go and make that accounts of that temple, like what should be income and expenditure, how the balance sheet, how the different assets will be valued. You do everything, present it, you will be assessed on that. Nearby village is there, so a group of students were sent to the nearby village and they were asked to prepare, select one farm and how the farmer will be maintaining its account, how the cattle, how the farm output will be valued and how it will be sewn into the accounts. You just do everything and then you will be assessed on the basis of that only. Because when a learner will be in the real world, he or she need not to learn, he or she need not to memorize the nitty-gritty of the accounting or the technology or anything or the management principles. Because once, say for example, a lawyer is not supposed to remember all the law. So when a particular case law will be referred to the lawyer or a chartered accountant or a company secretary or a doctor or an engineer, definitely they will be referring to certain books, and based on that reference only they will be drawing certain conclusion and they will try to bring certain solution to the problem. So if a person in the profession is not supposed to memorize all the things, then why we are pressurizing the students to memorize all those things? So a lawyer or a doctor or an engineer is able to bring solution because over a period of time he has learned something that, okay, if this is the case, so the problem is with this particular case law, so let us find the reference to that particular case law or the section, and accordingly he is trying to bring solutions. He is not supposed to remember everything because he has learned, he has not memorized. And learning has to be through multidimensional approach, strategies and paths. As I told you that it can be, there cannot be only one method of learning. There can be multidimensional approaches, strategies and paths. And it has to be holistic. Now, so far as the research is concerned, this is the learning and what changes are going to be there in the field of research. Basically, we have two types of institute. One is the research institute, which is also doing we have teaching institute which also do research, and we have research institute which also do teaching. So the research part will be now taken care of by the National Research Foundation. So there will be a National Research Foundation which will take care of the research part of the teaching institute or the research institute. So definitely this is going to boost the research aspect in the higher education, especially in the management also. The structure of the institute, it has to be multidisciplinary. So our universities are already multidisciplinary, and especially the management education is already a multidisciplinary. It has to be knowledge hub, large student population. This is one thing, there has to be large student population because it is also focusing on the gross enrollment ratio of the students. So ultimately in the days to come, there will be large student population. And since there will be large number of students and the teaching student ratio is 10:1, so there will be more number of teachers. And how this more number of teachers will be coming? So there has to be large number of researchers, because a researcher will be teacher in the days to come. So there will be large number of researchers, and teachers and students should be drawn equitably from all over India. This is another issue, and it's a concern which needs to be addressed. Because so long as our universities are concerned, or even the management education, it is very skewed in favor of the geographical locality where it is located. So this is an issue which needs to be addressed, that students and teachers has to be drawn from all over India. So how this has to be addressed, this is another concern. Industry academia interface, this is another focus of our national education policy. The university, just now Professor Singh and Professor Sharma have presented that large number of Indian graduates are not employable. I also stressed on this thing that our education system has created a battery of unemployed people. Now, if you ask the industries, why are you not employing them? Industry will simply say that they are not employable, they are not of our use. But how do we know? We as an academician will know that what is the need of the university? What university need? So that accordingly we can manufacture the students from our factory and we can deliver them to the industries. So for this, there has to be a continuous dialogue between industry and academia. In management education, there is one industry-academy interface point that is in the form of summer internship that we are sending our students to the industries for summer internship. So this is only one point. So there is a need to increase this kind of meeting points between industry and academia as much as possible. One possible solution is the industry MBA or industry PhD, PhD for the working professionals. So this working professional who are working in some of the industries, they are really a pool of knowledge, but their pool of knowledge, it is not documented anywhere. And suppose if a person who is working in Life Insurance Corporation of India for the last 30 years, he has a strong and huge pool of knowledge. And if this pool of knowledge can be documented, it can be a good repository of knowledge and it can help or it can guide the future generations. So it is similarly, a person who is working in telecom or a person is working in bank or a person working in defense, they have a huge pool of knowledge, but unfortunately we do not have any system to tap or to leverage those pool of knowledge. So can we have a model that welcome those people to our university and let them pursue PhD in the area in which they have expertise, and so that their experience, the expertise which they have gathered over a period of time, that can be documented and that can be an interesting pool of knowledge for the future generations. In Indian Institute of Information Technology, we have started one program that is PhD for working professionals. We have another program, MBA by research, and M.Tech by research. So all these are actually for the working professionals only. Similarly, Indian Institute of Management Bangalore and the NITI Mumbai, they have also started their executive PhD program. IIM Ahmedabad was already having their EPBX, like executive MBA. This is only for the executives. So these are some of the points through which we can increase the collaboration between industry and academia, and so that we can understand what is the need of the industries and the industries can also guide us that what is their requirement, and so that we can accordingly frame the curriculum and we can prepare our students which will be suitable for the industries. Internationalization is another point. So it has already been stressed upon by our previous speaker, so I will not. So internationalization now, just in short, that foreign universities will be opening campuses in India and Indian universities can also open campus outside India. Recently, we are going to have collaboration with the University of Uzbekistan and one British university. So we are now going to offer dual degree. So where the students will be admitted in Triple IIT Allahabad. So the first year of MBA will be pursued by the students at Triple IIT, and the second year of the MBA they will be going to University of Uzbekistan or Samarkand University. So in that way this internationalization is happening. So for this we need more number of MOUs. Another focus in the national education policy is that researchers should teach. The teachers should be autonomous on how to teach and research, and the universities would be autonomous on what to teach and research and how to teach and research while adhering to the theme of the institution. It is multidisciplinary integration of arts and humanities with science and technology will be there. So our universities are already having all the departments, so that integration will not be a problem. Flexible curriculum, that's another issue which needs to be addressed. Multiple exit points, learning from different origins, because I already told that there has to be, the focus is on learning, and the learning cannot be only from one origin, that in the classroom, it can be from any multiple origins. So that focus is on learning. And since there will be internationalization and the learning, flexible curriculum, so there is an issue of credit transfer, that students admitted in Assam University can opt to have some of his credits from Delhi University or IIM Ahmedabad or IIT Madras, and that's why he can obtain some of his credits from other institutes. And then there will be a need to develop certain mechanisms, so that is an issue and it has to be addressed. So MOUs, because if I admitted in Assam University, I directly cannot go to Delhi University or any other institute. So I can go to any institute only when we have some memorandum of undertakings with those institutions. So now in the coming days, there will be more number of MOUs from one university with another university in India, outside India. So this is an issue and this has to be addressed. How these MOUs will be implemented, this will be a challenge for the administrators. There are certain issues, like we have talked about all these things. So now immediate issue is that our ordinance has to be embedded with all these objectives. So long as our ordinance are having only one set of objectives and one framework is there, now there is a need to change our ordinance immediately. And maintaining the true spirit of national education policy is also a very important issue. It should not only kind of window dressing that we have implemented the national education policy. So the spirit behind the national education policy, that developing India and making India a stronger nation in the days to come, is the true spirit, with reminding the students and the citizens the glory of India. That is the spirit of national education policy. Harmonization with the global standards. So in India only, that our national education policy says that there will be one curriculum and one kind of framework all over India. So this is one problem. But now, since there will be globalization of education and global universities will be coming to India and Indian universities will be going global, so there has to be a harmonization and synchronization with the global standards. Evaluation of students is another issue. As I told you, that so long as our focus is on only examination, so that change in the perspective is also another issue which needs to be addressed. And development of materials in the vernacular language is another issue, because now education policy is also stressing that the initial years of a child will be spent in learning the things in the vernacular language only. So that will be an emergent issue. And payment to the international teachers, because once we are going international and we are asking international teachers to come to teach India, so the payment to the international teacher is also one of the very important issue. Recently we have conducted one workshop and we have invited one foreign speaker to speak, and when we are about to pay the honorarium, so apart from the banking problem, that the SWIFT code and everything, the government of India is imposing a tax of 39% on the foreign payment. So if I'm paying 100 rupees, so effectively that person is getting only 61 rupees. So this is one issue. Number two, if you have to pay in dollars, so if in India we are paying to one teacher say 5,000 rupees, so for per class, so that's a good amount, a reasonable amount, but 5,000 converted in dollar minus 39% tax, so it is just a few dollars, which is very embarrassing as a part of organizer or as an institute to pay to a foreign teachers. So this is another issue which will be coming, which I am apprehending that this will come in future. So all these things needs to be addressed. So how to achieve it? This is a concern. Multidimensional, multicultural, multilingual students and programs will be there, and how this will be addressed and how it will be embedded in one framework. This is another concern. one model does not fit all, so that's why there is a requirement that there has to be a flexible model by maintaining the true spirit of national education policy. There will be resistance to change because since last 34 years, not 34 years, last 75 years, we have been practicing one particular model, and now all of a sudden we are asked to change that model. So definitely there will be resistance to change. So how to deal that resistance to change, that will be a big issue, a big problem and challenge for the university and administrators of in the higher education, for the government as well. There will be huge requirement of resource, as the government is already saying that we need to spend around 6% of our GDP in education, and right now we are spending less than 4% of our GDP in education. So increase of 2%, and rightly pointed out by Professor Amritlal Ghosh sir, that that 3% will be for research only. So for the education it is left only 3%, which is even lesser than the current allocation. So there will be a huge resource requirement. So how to deal with that, that is also another concern that needs to be addressed. And multiple exit points, a scholar completing certain credits can be given a degree diploma. Now not a scholar, but any person who will be completing certain credits will be given certain degree and diploma. And this is a concern that there will be a more number of students coming to university system for getting PhD degree because they are not getting employment anywhere else, and they will be getting a scholarship, and after some time they might decide that we are not going to submit our thesis and give us a research degree because multiple exit options are available. And this is another concern which needs to be addressed. And therefore future university will be, and university should be, a research intensive institute with interdisciplinary foundation. So this is what should be the structure of a university in future in nutshell. So thank you for patience hearing. That's all from my side. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.